In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father, who raised his Son Jesus Christ from the dead, be with you all. In the waters of baptism, David died with Christ. May he now rise with him and share in his everlasting glory. In life, David cherished the gospel of Christ. May he now hear the words of our Saviour. Come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you since the foundation of the world. Welcome everybody to Our Lady in St. John's Church as we gather to celebrate the funeral liturgy for David Holgate, to thank God for his life and to pray for the repose of his soul. And as well as seeing all of you, family and friends of David, it's also good for me to be able to welcome Father Michael McCormack, who is a very good friend of the Holgate family. Let us now join in singing the entrance hymn, Lord of all hopefulness, Lord of all joy. We are gathered in this church to pray for the repose of David's soul and to find comfort and consolation ourselves in our loss. When someone close to us dies, it brings a lot of things into perspective. In a flash, we see the only thing that matters in the long run is the goodness of our lives and the quality of our relationships. Let us pray for David, for Mary, for their children, Rosemary, Lucy, Ian and Michael, and for all David's family and friends. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant David, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. Now would you please be seated for the first reading.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord will destroy death forever. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will prepare for all peoples a banquet of rich food. On this mountain, he will remove the mourning veil covering all peoples and the shroud enwrapping all nations. He will destroy death forever.
The Lord will wipe away the tears from every cheek. He will take away his people's shame everywhere on earth. The Lord has said so. That day it will be said, "See, this is our God, in whom we hoped for salvation. The Lord is the one in whom we hoped. We exult and we rejoice that he has saved us."
Let us now stand to listen to the words of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Gospel.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Seeing the crowds, Jesus went up the hill. There he sat down and was joined by his disciples. And then he began to speak. This is what he taught them. How happy are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy the gentle, they shall have the earth for their heritage. Happy those who mourn, they shall be comforted. Happy those who hunger and thirst for what is right, they shall be satisfied. Happy the merciful, they shall have mercy shown them. Happy the pure in heart, they shall see God. Happy the peacemakers, they shall be called sons and daughters of God. Happy those who are persecuted in the cause of right, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Happy are you when people abuse you and persecute you and speak all kinds of calumny against you on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward will be great in heaven. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Would you please be seated once more? David, in his life, showed the qualities that Jesus talks about in the Beatitudes and the qualities that Jesus showed in his own life and ministry too. Our translation of the Gospel translates the original Greek makarios as happy, but a better translation is blessed, which expresses the joy in life, which is the gift of God, and doesn't rely on how we are feeling at any particular time or our current emotional state. The world says, blessed are the rich, for they can have anything they want. But Jesus says, blessed are the poor in spirit, who realize that it is not the amount of money we have, but the sort of people we are that makes us truly rich. The world says, blessed are those who live it up. But Christ says, blessed are those who mourn. It is only those who can love who can truly mourn. To open our heart to others is to share their burdens and sorrows and to begin to live fully. The world says, blessed are the tough and the strong. But Jesus says, blessed are the gentle. Gentleness is not a form of weakness, but a form of great strength. Life calls for a lot of gentleness, the gentleness in the hands of a mother or a surgeon. The world says, blessed are those who show no mercy and take no prisoners. But Christ says, blessed are the merciful, those who make allowances for the sins and weaknesses of others, and whose greatness rests in their ability to forgive. The world says, blessed are the troublemakers, the warmongers. But Christ says, blessed are the peacemakers, those who spread understanding among people, who welcome the stranger, who work for a more just society. The things the Beatitudes give us in this life are important and necessary, and a foretaste of what is to come. David lived life to the full and made the most of the opportunities that God gave him. May he now be enjoying the fullness of life and health and strength in God's presence in heaven. Now would you all please stand for the bidding prayers, and we'll be led in prayer by Rosemary and Lucy. God the Almighty Father, raise Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
We thank God for the life of David, for all the happy times we shared with him. and for the many good works he did. We take comfort knowing that he is at peace. Lord, hear us. We pray for all who are here today and the many people who have helped us with practical support and all his friends who kept him cheerful when they visited him. Lord, hear us.
Lord.
We pray for all David's family who have gone before him. May he be reunited with them in God's kingdom. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all who care for the sick and the dying, for the doctors and nurses, and the carers who looked after Pat with such dignity, respect, and cheerfulness during the last few months of his life. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for all the Chinakalu communities, and we thank them for all their prayers and support. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We pray for friends and relatives who are unable to be here today and are participating in this service through live streaming. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
I don't want to give lots of thoughts because it's a very emotional moment, but I just want to say what a privilege has been for me as a priest to be that have known David and Mary and my experience with them, with the Chinakalu community, and what a beautiful gentleman, a loving, loving man David was. And it's lovely that Martin's here this morning from London. He was one of the first lads that spoke to David. He was his mentor as he entered the community. David lived the Beatitudes. He helped broken people. My prayer is that God will bless him with the gift of eternal life and give comfort to all the family, because you're a family of faith, and that faith will sustain you in this time. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in the kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. Now would you please be seated for the eulogy.
Try to do this as well as I can. I don't share Dad's flair for public speaking, but I'll do my best. Thank you all for coming to celebrate Dad's life with us here today. Dad was loving husband to Mary, brother to Pat, Joan, and Sean, father to me, Ian, Mike, Rosemary, and Lucy, and a friend to many of you here today, and always a gentleman. Dad was born in Upton, but plans had already been put in place by his parents, Don and Nora, to move halfway across the world to begin a new life in Rhodesia. And they took him and his elder sister Pat there as babies. Dad lived there for the next 14 or 15 years, and with another sister, Joan, a rival, and their brother, Sean, they lived a very different life than anyone else back here in the UK. When I was young, Dad would tell us stories of bullfrogs in our grand's shoes, dropping lizards from the trees onto unsuspecting locals, injuries from vicious dogs and monkeys, and also how lucky we were that we didn't have the terror of Mac the Tack in our lives, who was a teacher that would carry a tacky or plimsoll in his back pocket and wouldn't hesitate to use it on a pupil's backside. He loved growing up there so much so that when he returned to England and was sent to Pensbeat High School, he would take his shoes off on the way there, as he didn't really like wearing footwear, He also retained his Rhodesian accent that not many would recognise unless they had been there too, in which case they would immediately ask where in Rhodesia he had lived, and he would talk about those days with fondness. Dad was adventurous and relished a challenge. As a teenager back in England, he undertook the Duke of Edinburgh's award, and for his gold award, he had to choose a residential placement. So Dad obviously chose to go to Nigeria for 12 months to work in an outward bound school. While he was there in 1967, the Biafran War broke out, and again, Dad would tell us stories of working at the school, being taken over by the Nigerian army, an eventual escape overnight and trekking through the jungle to Lagos, and then working his passage home. Dad didn't ever take the easy route. He was very proud to have been given the award by the Prince of Edinburgh at Buckingham Palace, and he always encouraged me, my brother and sisters, to be outgoing, adventurous, and to do whatever we chose to do to the best of our abilities. I hope we've made him proud in that respect. He was a clerk at Shot and Steelworks at the beginning of a long career with various different manufacturing companies. He worked hard, he went to night school to gain academic qualifications, and rose through the levels of factory management, and eventually retired from Sharp some years ago. But it was when he was not at work that Dad really loved life. You will have gathered by now, there were lots of stories of his past, and many of them were in the company of Rob Wilson, Dad's oldest friend, who unfortunately can't be here with us today. Apparently Rob was a bad influence, but I don't think Dad needed much encouragement. He would tell us about regular camping trips in North Wales, their motorbikes, swimming in rivers and lakes, and the fun they had. One idea Rob came up with was to join a local amateur dramatic society. I think it was a great way to meet some girls. And there, Dad met Mary, who became his wife and our mum. Their relationship is one of the strongest I have ever seen. They were a united partnership that saw many challenges and had many differences, but always went forward together and overcame all obstacles. The sense of adventure never stopped when us children became part of his life, and camping was always the best summer holiday we could have, whether we liked it or not. We camped in Wales, Scotland, France, and we always did enjoy it. Dad was a firm believer that if there was something that was worth buying to improve our lives or enjoy, he wouldn't buy it and he'd make one better. So we had many gadgets, go-karts, and even a canoe that he made by hand. And true to his word, they were better sometimes, but they are certainly very memorable. And not one to change his ways, I was tidying Dad's tools last week and found that one of his spades must have broken the handle. So Dad had whittled a large stick, then fixed it into the spade instead of buying a new handle. It still works well. There was one passion in Dad's life that was constant. Even as camping gave way to B&Bs and B&Bs gave way to hotels, the game of golf was one thing that Dad loved from a teenager in Rhodesia, right to the end. He became a member at Heswell Golf Club when he returned to England from Rhodesia. He had a small break when we moved to Scotland in the 80s, but rejoined as soon as we returned. He loved the game, the course, the club, and the friends he made there. Dad played an active part in the club and took on roles of some of the committees that helped run the club so well. And then in 2008, he was asked to become the club captain. I know that Dad was very surprised for a short time, completely bowled over by the invitation. But he quickly accepted the role, and I know he was very, very proud during his year as Heswell Golf Club captain. He continued to play regularly until recently. And even when Dad couldn't play anymore, there was nothing more that he loved. Having the lads come round to the house following a round of golf and telling him how much or how well or badly they had done that day. The game and friends he has made have given him so much joy in his life. There are many other activities that Dad joined in throughout his whole life and friends he made there, including trampolining, the round table, squash, Scottish dancing, and his work for the Shinakolo organisation. I apologise for not having the time to talk about each one of these or the times Dad had with the friends he made there, but I know he will have left his mark with those who met him. Most of all, though, Dad loved his family. Mary, his dad, Don, and his mum, Nora, his brothers and sisters, and his children. He was proud of all of us, although we have all inherited a fraction of his adventurous nature and lived in very many different places, he was very happy we were all around him right at the end. We have relations in far-flung parts of the world, many who can't be with us here today, especially Dad's sister Pat in South Africa, who we all know is very upset that she can't be physically here today, but is with us due to the modern technology and certainly in spirit. We will all miss him, but also remember him in so many ways. He was truly inspirational. Bye, Dad.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for coming today. Thank you to Ian, who's done a fantastic job telling you about Dad's adventurous life. My memories of Dad and the stories he would tell us growing up are also just as inspiring. But I'd like to talk to you today about what Dad was like as a dad and the things we did together and what he taught us. Dad was lucky to have had two excellent parents himself, who were not only able to provide for him, but was also so family-orientated. I think this is what helped him become such a phenomenal father and guide him in the way he brought us up. As Ian mentioned, Dad was always making or fixing things. He was able to spend time with each of us, teaching us how things worked, showing us how to use his tools from the tool shed, fix bikes, make go-karts, or work on different woodwork projects we would try out. Health and safety was never high on Dad's list of priorities. He never really seemed to mind us getting out his power drills and drilling away at something, even at the age of 10 or younger. His views on health and safety pretty much stayed the same with him throughout his life, and it was no surprise to me or Ian to come into a house we were working on together to find him using a petrol strimmer to strim down an overnote garden in a pair of shorts and open-toe sandals, or even once at the top of a bent set of wooden ladders with the rungs missing. Dad used to teach us how to read a compass and a map and would set out orienteering routes for us to follow. We'd follow the bearings and count our steps to find the next set of coordinates. I didn't realise at the time, but the skills he gave us growing up when teaching us all these things would be skills we'd use again and again, I still use today. Dad was a great problem solver. Again, this didn't change much from when we were young and he was used as initiative and whatever he had at hand to overcome problems that occurred. Dad had a very logical mindset, and when it came to a problem, he would consider the facts in front of him and make his decision based on these facts. He saw nothing wrong with tying the corners of a handkerchief together and putting them overhead to keep the sun off him. The fact we would see him working in the garden like this and burst out laughing didn't seem to bother him. He saw it as a logical solution for overcoming a problem. Nonetheless, it would be fair to say, fashion was never high on his list of priorities. Luckily for me, I seem to have passed it by, however. Ian seems to have inherited the same fashion trait. Dad always seems to have the answer. Working with him when we were renewing houses, he always knew what to do. It was reassuring to know you could always talk over a problem with Dad. I come away with a clear idea of what to be able to do about it. Throughout his life, Dad was fun to be around. When we were children, our car was a blue work van. Mum and Dad sat in the front, and me and Ian would sit on the inside wheel arches in the back of the van. I'm not sure what Rose did. Maybe we left her at home. This would be great entertainment, especially when we had birthday parties, and about 8 of our friends would pile into the back of the van and go swimming, which was the standard birthday outing back then. As we would drive, he would throw the van all over the road, throwing us from side to side inside the van, which was always great fun and always resulted in someone coming out with a thick lip or bruises. Again, good old 1980, health and safety. As I got older, it was always uplifting to pick up the phone and hear Dad's upbeat voice on the end of the line. He was always interested in what we were doing, whether it would be somewhere we'd been out with the family together or something to do with work and how things were progressing. Over the last few years, Mum and Dad enjoyed some amazing holidays together. They spent 6 weeks travelling through New Zealand in a camper van and did absolutely everything you could imagine, from exploring glaciers to getting helicopter trips across the mountain peaks. Only a couple of years ago, they trekked 90 kilometres in Spain to visit a pilgrimage site, and in typical Dad fashion, after Mum had been practising by walking the Wirral coastline in the lead up to the event, Dad just said, "I'll do it on the day." And seemingly he did with no problems. He spent a couple of weeks sailing the coastline of the Mediterranean and cruised the fjords of Norway. And it's definitely fair to say, not only did Dad make the most of his time here, but he enjoyed life right up to the end. And next year would have been Next year would have been Mum and Dad's 50th wedding anniversary. A promise from Dad was golden, no matter how busy he was at work or how late he got in. We always knew that if Dad had said it, then he would make it happen and he wouldn't let us down. We'd be encouraged to achieve things like swimming badges or later on exam grades. Often the rewards for making these achievements could be something like a Star Wars figure of Luke Skywalker or Han Solo. I remember achieving one of my swimming certificates, but none of the shops having any of the figures left. My disappointment was soon relieved from this when Dad unexpectedly came home from work, turned off all the lights in the house and brought out a lightsaber he had bought instead. He had delivered above and beyond, as always. As I stand here now, I'm a father to my own 2 children, Evie and Isla, and I think about what it is to be a dad to my own children. I believe a father's job is to bring your children up, to be good people, and to be able to stand on their own 2 feet and make their own way in the world. I'd like to think this is what Dad has done for myself, for Ian, for Rose, and for Lucy, who are all good people. We are all independent adults, and we know our path, and we all have Dad to thank for this. I now consider it as my job to pass on the kindness and love and teachings that Dad showed us to my own children and to bring them up in a way Dad would have loved to see. I promise. Thank you very much.
Would you now please all stand for the final commendation and farewell. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother David in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon David in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. In peace, let us take David to his place of rest.